Preparing the lecture slides before the lecture, hopefully at the end of the weekend, at the end of the week or during the weekend, and I will advise you to download those slides and go through before coming to the lecture. And secondly, it will be shared with the recording on MS Teams later, so that you can find the answers of your queries. And thirdly, if you still have some questions or answers or questions to be answered, so you'll have time during the online class to ask those questions, and also through the WhatsApp group, the queries will be tackled or answered accordingly. So let me also share the slide with you. So I have already shared the link of to download the slides. So I hope most of you have done that downloading. So can I know how many of you have downloaded the slides for the first lecture? Please raise hand so that I should know your interest in the subject. And today I also shared the slides of the second lecture, so that should also get because the next week we have to cover that also, and also we have to start with the next topic. So that also the slides of which I also shared at the end of this week, hopefully. So up till now 16 they have raised hand, 15, 16, so it's good. It means some of you have, or maybe around 50% have done this. That's very good. And I hope you have also gone through that, not only just downloaded it, you have gone through the slides. If you have not done so, please go through it after the lecture. And those who have not downloaded the slides, so they should also do it at the earliest. And also the slides of the second lecture should also be downloaded before the next week's scheduled class. Okay, you can now inactive this hand raise. Okay, so let us start with our first of all introduction to the subject, theory subject, and then further we'll continue with our first topic today for this course outline. Okay, so this subject name is Fluid Mechanics 2. It's theory subject that I'm going to introduce over here. As far as the lab subject for the FM2 is concerned, so you have already been introduced in last lecture or last week's lecture. Its course code is CE331. CE is for civil engineering, and 3 is for the third year, and 31 is the code number given to it for this subject, for the registration of this subject, for the approval of this subject. It has 3 contact hours that will have combined one in a week, or for some subjects you may have 2 plus 1, 2 hour lecture and then 1 hour lecture. So we have in this subject combined 3 hours, so we have to utilize them in best possible way. Credit hours for this subject are 3, theory subject are 3. Now, as the name indicates, it's Fluid Mechanics 2. We should know what are fluids and what is fluid mechanics, so that you should understand what is the scope of it, what we cover in this. It's a very broad field. It's a very important and conceptual, you can say, field of hydraulics, where the concepts are discussed, where the equations, derivation is discussed, etc. Fluid, and it has wide range of application, not only in civil engineering but also in other fields of engineering and mechanical and others. So fluids are the substances which are capable of flowing. It means whenever the conditions will be made to flow them, so they will flow. It means that they can also be at rest, not all the time they are flowing. So whenever the conditions are there, they will flow. So they are capable of flowing. And they do not have their confirmed shape. In fact, they confirm the shape of the container in which they are placed or they are put. And the third very important property is that when they are at rest, there are no shearing stresses or tangential stresses or forces developed, or they cannot resist or sustain the tangential or shear forces. When they are flowing, depending on the viscosity and also indicated by Newton's equation of viscosity and Newton's law of viscosity, when the fluids are flowing, so their adjacent layers, they slide over the other, and in between them there is a shearing stress developed, which is the measure of the viscosity of the fluid. So when they are flowing, there is certain shear stress developed, there is certain shear stress they sustain, and when they are at rest, there is no shear stress which they can sustain or which is present there. Fluid mechanics, you know, mechanics is the branch of sciences dealing with the response of objects, bodies at rest or in motion. And fluid mechanics, when you replace the word body or object with the fluid, so it is the fluid mechanics branch of sciences dealing with the response of fluids, study of fluids either at rest or in motion. That when the fluids are at rest, what forces or energies they have, how much forces energy they apply on the other interacting surfaces or objects, like if in case of a dam or retaining wall, so or the swimming pool, how much forces force water will have on the sides, on the dam, and similarly when they are flowing, like in rivers, canals, in pipelines, etc. So how much energy, what energies and forces they are carrying, how they are calculated, and how they interact with the conduit in which they are flowing and other objects which come in their way. So this, as I mentioned, is a very vast field, this fluid mechanics. So we deal with the static response of the fluid separately. It's called fluid statics. And we deal with the dynamic response of the fluids, that is fluid in motion, in dynamics part or the fluid dynamics. Then hydraulics is also a branch of the fluid mechanics. So there are different branches it has. So it shows that it's a very broad and very vast field, and it has wide range of applications. Coming to the textbooks. For my course, my parts part to be covered, the first book will be the reference book. Most of the things will be taken from that. So I will prefer and advise you to have this book, at least the relevant chapters. It will also help you out in other subjects like hydraulics, etc. So it's a very good book on fluid and hydraulics. That is Fluid Mechanics with Engineering Applications by Dougherty, Franzini and Fenimore. So you should get it's a metric edition. That will be used, especially we'll do some exercises relating to our chapters that we'll cover. So you should have this book so that you can read out the statements, what data is given, so that will be beneficial in this way as well. Other books are for the reference of the course, which will be taught by Engineer Weiser. So she will obviously let you know more about them. Mass distribution, you are already well aware of it, and mostly for all subjects it's sort of similar. We have like in this case two parts of the subject, like in fact they are separate subjects, fluid mechanics to theory and fluid mechanics to lab. So both have 100 marks in that we take to evaluate a student, and as far as the theory marks are concerned, so total 100 marks. Class participation. So that this is a typical trend that we follow. Obviously, during this pandemic and the way the things are going and the way they will go, it depends on that whether we'll have the midterm and others, or we may have some comprehensive exams. It's too early to call. Obviously, we'll have to wait till the next decision that how it will unfold. Then we have this in this class participation had 10 marks. It include your attendance, your assignments that you'll submit, you'll be given, and you accordingly submit. So this will be overall class participation. Now coming to the chapters or topics that we have to cover as a part of this course. So first four topics, the first one, steady uniform flow of incompressible fluids through circular pipes, forces on immersed bodies, dimensional analysis, flow kinematics are basic hydrodynamics. So these topics will be covered by me, and these are the chapters of Dougherty book. Like first topic is the chapter number 8, second one is chapter number 10, third one is chapter number 7, and fourth one is chapter number 5. And the rest of the topics, impact of jet impulse and reaction turbine, centrifugal pumps, reciprocating pumps will be covered by Engineer Weiser. So in midterm, up to midterm course, I'll be covering topic number 3 and 4. That is, we'll start with the basic hydrodynamics today. It's chapter number 5 of Dougherty book, and then we'll cover forces on immersed bodies at chapter number 10 of Dougherty book. And after the mids, we'll complete the other two topics, that is steady uniform flow through circular pipes and dimensional analysis. Now, based on this coursework and also as a part of OBE system that you know we have shifted to it from 2014 onward, outcome-based education. So as a part of it, it is compulsory for all subjects to have well-defined approved course learning outcomes. The outcome that the student should achieve numerically and also by achieving the relevant knowledge after completing that particular coursework. So for this FM2 subject, the CLOs which have been set for it based on the course content, the number one is to analyze laminar and turbulent flow regimes in circular pipes. It's the first one. And this will be contributed by the first topic, that is flow through circular pipes. Then we have the second one as to apply dimension analysis techniques for the development of equations in functional form. So in this we learn for the different given phenomena, you will select the main variables and you will try to develop a relationship between them. That is called as a dimension based on using the dimensions of the parameter involved in the phenomenon. So the topic number 3, dimensional analysis, will contribute to this CLO. For CLO 1, the relevant PLO is problem analysis, that is PLO 2, and cognitive level is C4. And for CLO 2, its relevant PLO is design and development solution, which is PLO 3, and its cognitive level is C3. The third one is to classify various types of flows considering fluid elements in motion. So topic number 2, that is forces on immersed bodies, and 3, that is fluid flow kinematics or basic hydrodynamics, they will contribute to CLO3, and its relevant PLO is PLO1, that is engineering knowledge. I will not go for any design or analysis over here, so you will be provided with the engineering knowledge in these topics, and cognitive level is C4. The fourth one is to evaluate the design of various types of turbines and pumps using impulse momentum principle. So in this the topics which will be covered by Engineer Weiser, they will contribute to this CLO, and its relevant PLO is PLO4 investigation, and its cognitive level is going to be C5. So these are the course learning outcomes that the student should achieve, or they should be able to do the following after completing this course. Tentative lecture delivery plan, as I mentioned that in the first 4 weeks, I will be covering my midterm course, and then for the rest part before mid, Engineer Weiser will take up the theory classes and she will cover her course for the mids. And then after the midterm, I will again take up the theory classes and complete my course contents. And later part of the semester, Engineer Weiser will take up the classes and complete her course contents. So in this way, it will follow. Now coming to the first topic that we'll start with today, that is lecture number 1 for the first week. First week lecture was missed, so obviously it's the same that will continue in this week. Elementary hydrodynamics. And it is it will contribute to CLO3 partly, and it's relevant to PLO1. Now coming to the introduction, first of all, what is elementary hydrodynamics? So it is the branch of fluid mechanics, obviously, which deals with the study of fluid mechanics or fluids or fluid phenomena purely based on mathematics, considering the elements of fluid in motion. So hydrodynamics means fluid in motion, study of fluids in motion. And elementary hydrodynamics, it is defined as the study of fluid mechanics based on purely mathematical terms or mathematical equations. You will see in this topic that we will derive certain equations for various fluid flow phenomena, and based on those mathematical expression we will define like continuity, rotational, irrotational flow, etc. According to you have already in your FM1 course you have discussed certain basic properties of the fluid and other topics. So in this course also some continuation will be there from that subject. That's why it is a prerequisite to register in this FM2 course. So FM1 is prerequisite, it should be passed by the student so that it can register in this course. Anyhow, so you will have some continuation from that point where you what we learned in FM1, and we will have certain more advanced knowledge and topics that will be part of this course. So you have in that course learned about the various types of flows like steady, unsteady flow with respect to time. If the flow and fluid properties are not varying, it is steady, and if it is varying, they are unsteady flow. And similarly, you have learned about the uniform and non-uniform flow. If with respect to distance or length of the channel or pipe, the flow and fluid properties are not changing, it's a uniform flow. If they are changing with time, with length, it is non-uniform flow. And you have also learned the laminar and turbulent flow. For laminar flow, the fluid particles, they follow distinct path. It is in the form of laminations, movement in the form of lamination, and then these paths, they are not intersected by each other. That is called laminar flow. And it is also in detail we'll discuss in our first topic that was listed in the course outline, that is flow through circular pipes. So how to check it physically, whether the flow is laminar or not, we have one Reynolds apparatus there where we have the pipe flow, and we put some dye in that at the center of the pipe through, or inject some dye at the center of the pipe. So if that dye remains straight, the line of the flow of the dye color remains same. So it is a laminar flow, and if it mixed up and it dispersed, so it is basically the turbulent flow. Anyhow, so we have learned laminar flow and turbulent flow, where the one where fluid particles, they intersect each other's path, they do not have the definite path along the flow. Another way to differentiate or to classify the flow is based on the dimension of flow, or based on how many dimensions we have taken to define a flow, or to how many velocity components physically, if you want to understand, we have taken to define that particular flow. So we can have one dimensional flow, two dimensional flow, and three dimensional flow. In simple words, one dimensional flow is the one where we have one velocity component, dominant velocity component to consider to completely define that flow, or the velocity has only one component along the direction of flow. In two dimensional flow, we have two velocity components to be considered to completely define that flow. And in the three-dimensional flow, we have the three components of velocity considered to completely define that particular flow. The same thing is mentioned over here. In one-dimensional flow, all streamlines are the lines showing the average direction of flow. So is the average direction of the flow followed by the fluid. So streamlines are parallel to each other. They are also called as the flow lines. They are parallel to each other, and there is one velocity vector or component in the direction of flow. So there is only one velocity component that is mostly in the direction of x-axis along the direction of flow. That is called one-dimensional flow. For example, flow in pipelines of constant diameter, you can say flow in the channels of constant area, etc. So these may be few examples of the one-dimensional flow. In reality, all flows are three-dimensional. So we'll have actually three components of velocity. If you along a pipeline draw the velocity profile, so we'll see that velocity will have in different direction will have different components. Similarly, especially in case of channels, if you draw the velocity profile, so you'll have along the length, along the depth, and along the width, velocity will be different. Velocity components will be there. But for simplification and for the flows, where one or two dominant velocity components are there. So accordingly, we can convert three-dimensional flow to two-dimensional flow, or maybe to one-dimensional flow. Similarly, two-dimensional flow is the one in which streamlines are not parallel to each other in a plane, but are identical in parallel plane. So there are two velocity components in x and y direction. So like flow is over a spillway or weir. So in that case, flow lines, they become curvy. They come in curvature. So they are not parallel to each other. But if you take each flow line separately in a separate plane, are in parallel plane, so they will look identical. So this is a two-dimensional flow. In three-dimensional flow, the streamlines, they are neither parallel to each other in a plane nor identical in parallel plane. So there are three velocity components actually in x, y, and z direction. So there can be many examples in this case also, like flow at the convergence or divergence of channel, at the entrance of pipe, etc. Similarly, some other examples can also be given for the three-dimensional flow, where we have velocity components equally important in all three directions. They have significance in all three directions. Now coming to our first main topic of this elementary hydrodynamics is the derivation of differential equation of continuity. So differential equation of continuity, you know already what is equation of continuity in simplest form. That is, mass flow rate at any particular section of a conduit or channel is same, is equal to the mass flow rate at any other section. So here you learn the differential equation of continuity and its derivation for three-dimensional or two-dimensional flows. Now let us start with this. So firstly let me explain the figure given to you in this. So you have been given three mutually perpendicular fluid elements, as you can see. Three axes actually, x, y, and z. Three mutually perpendicular axes are given to you, and along these axes, there are three components of velocity are given. U is along x-axis, as you can see in the diagram. V is along y-axis, and W is along the z-axis. So three mutually perpendicular axes, which are fixed in space, and three accordingly. Components of velocity along x, y, and z, u, v, and w respectively are given. Now, if you see in the diagram, you are given with the three-dimensional fluid element. This is a three-dimensional fluid element given to you. Three-dimensional fluid element is given, this one. It is the three-dimensional differential element of fluid. This is called as a parallelepiped. Parallelepiped is like a square in two dimension. In three dimension, the same is known as parallelepiped. So it's a three-dimensional differential element of the fluid given to you. It has six sides. This one is the left-hand side, and this is the right-hand side along x-axis. It has bottom side and the top side along z-axis. It has front side and the back side along the y-axis. Now if you see along the x-axis, the left hand side where the mass flow rate is entering into the fluid element, so this is the mass flow rate entering rho into u into the area, this area in normal to the velocity. This is the mass flow rate, rho u into the area. What is this area? This is delta y into delta z. This is the area multiplied by rho u. This is the mass flow rate entering from left hand side of this element along x axis. Now along x axis, from the right hand face, this is the mass flow rate leaving. That is rho u. This is one which is entering, has reached over here. Now the variation of this rho u over the distance delta x, that is partial rho u or partial x into delta x. So at the point of leaving this right hand face from along the x axis, the mass flow rate will be rho u into partial rho u or partial x into delta x, and all multiplied by the area, that is delta y into delta z. So this is the mass flow rate leaving the along the x axis from the right hand face. Similarly, you can write rho into W for z axis entering and rho w plus partial rho w or partial z into delta z for the leaving mass flow rate along z axis. Similarly, for y axis, the mass flow rate entering will be rho into v, velocity along y axis, and leaving will be rho into v plus partial rho v or partial y into delta y into the area that will be delta z into delta x. So similarly, for all faces, we can write along all directions x, y, and z, we can write the inflow, mass inflow, and mass outflow. The same thing, x, y, and z, which are mutually perpendicular and fixed in space, let the velocity components in these directions be u, v, and w respectively, u along x-axis, v along y-axis, and w along z-axis. Consider a differential element of fluid which is parallel a biped, as I mentioned, having sides delta x, delta y, and delta z. Now, the rate of mass flow in x direction, which is entering through left hand face, as I mentioned. So, we know that mass flow rate is the defined as the mass of the fluid entering a particular section, or mass flow rate, which is at a particular section per unit time. So mass over time is the mass flow rate. And we also know that mass is density into volume. So so it will be rho v over t. And we know that volume over time is volume flow rate, or simply flow rate. So mass flow rate in terms of volume flow rate is rho q. So this rho q is actually mass flow rate entering from left hand face along x-axis. Q is velocity into area. So it will be rho into u. U is the velocity along x-axis, and this is the area normal to velocity, delta y into delta z. So this is how we can write the mass flow rate entering from left-hand face along the x-axis. Then the mass flow rate, which is leaving the right-hand face along x-axis, that is rho u plus partial rho u or partial x into delta x. This is already explained in the figure. Into delta y into delta z. This is the mass flow rate which is leaving the right hand face along the x-axis. Now, considering the net mass flow rate along the x-axis or x direction, we have the mass inflow rho u delta y into delta z, and we have the mass outflow, which is minus rho u plus partial rho u partial delta x into delta y into delta z. So inflow minus outflow is the net mass flow rate. Now, further, if you put the values and multiply this delta x, delta y, delta z to these two terms in the bracket, so we have rho u delta y delta z with negative sign minus partial rho u partial x into delta y into delta z. So the first two terms same, there will be cancelled. Rho u delta y delta z minus rho u delta y delta z. And the net mass flow rate in x direction will be minus partial rho u partial x, delta x into delta y into delta z. So this is the net mass flow rate in x direction. Similarly, the net mass flow rate in y direction will be minus partial rho v or partial y, delta x, delta y into delta z. So this is the net mass flow rate in y direction. On the same line you did for the x direction, you can do it for the y direction. I think first of all mass inflow rate, and then mass outflow rate, and then taking the net inflow minus outflow, you'll get this. So the only thing which is different is, instead of u, which is velocity along x-axis, we have v, which is velocity along y-axis, and instead of partial x, we have partial y, which is the direct distance along x-axis, and this is distance along y-axis. Similarly, on the same lines, we can write the net mass flow rate in z direction, that is minus partial rho w or partial z into delta x into delta y to delta z. Again, just replacing the velocity component in that direction divided by the distance in that direction. Now, this is the mass flow rate in x, y, net mass flow rate in x, y, and z direction. So now if you combine these equations 3, 4, and 5, add these equations, we will get the net mass flow rate in three mutually perpendicular directions, that is net mass flow rate in the fluid element, you can say net mass flow rate for the entire fluid element, or for all mutually perpendicular directions, The net mass flow rate will be the sum of equation 3, 4 and 5. If you look at equation number 3, 4 and 5, the common thing is delta x, delta y, delta z. With the negative sign, that will be taken out. And the remaining will be partial rho u over partial x plus partial rho v over partial y plus partial rho w over partial z. So this is what we will be left with as the equation number 6, which is the net mass flow rate for the entire element. Now another way to define the same, that is rate of change of mass in the fluid element, is by writing this partial m over partial t, the rate of change of mass flow or mass flow rate. So we know that mass is density into volume of the element, rho into delta x, delta y, delta z is the volume of the element. So the rate of change of mass for the entire element is partial rho over partial t into delta x, delta y, delta z. Now the left hand side of equation 6 and 7 is same. Both equations are actually net mass flow rate for the entire element. So comparing equation number 6 and 7, is you see, just comparing the right hand side of the equation. So we have this delta x, delta y, delta z in both the equation, right hand side, it will be cancelled. So remaining equation number 8 will be partial rho u over partial x plus partial rho v over partial y plus partial rho w over partial z is equal to minus partial rho over partial t. This is known as the general equation of continuity for three-dimensional flow. Equation number 8 is general equation of continuity for three-dimensional flow, which is applicable for compressible and incompressible fluids and for steady and unsteady flow. Now in this topic, another topic also, we'll be dealing with the steady incompressible flows. So we can accordingly reduce this equation number 8 for steady flow first and then for the incompressible fluid. So that will be more easier to remember. So further reducing equation number 8 for steady flow, we know that in steady flow there is no change in the density of the fluid with respect to time. So partial rho over partial t will be 0. So putting the value in equation number 8 for this, so equation number 9 will be the three-dimensional continuity equation for steady flow with compressible or incompressible fluid. So partial rho u over partial x plus partial rho v over partial y plus partial rho w over partial z is equal to 0. Then we have, we can further reduce it to for the incompressible fluids. So we have for incompressible fluid, density is not changed. Density remains same in all directions. So we can take this density as constant in this equation number 9. And it, in this way, it will be taken out and it will be eliminated from equation 9 to make it equation 10. So equation 10 is the three-dimensional continuity equation for steady incompressible fluids, fluid flow. So this is partial u over partial x plus partial v over partial y plus partial w over partial z is equal to 0. So this is a three-dimensional continuity equation that you have to keep in mind. Now we can further reduce it to two dimension. If you can eliminate one direction, one dimension, that is z direction. So in two-dimensional form, the continuity equation for steady incompressible fluid flow will be partial u over partial x plus partial v over partial y is equal to 0. So what we have done in this, we have mathematically defined the continuity of the flow. So that's why it is, that's why we have defined elementary hydrodynamics as the study of fluid mechanics based on mathematics. So mathematically we have defined what is continuity equation or what is continuity of the flow. So now let us use this equation to check the continuity of certain flow fields, to check or comment whether the given flow fields are following the continuity or not, or in other words, whether these given flow fields, they are continuous or not. So let us see, this is a solved example 1 in chapter number 5. You can also go through it later if you have the book. And you can try with various values of u and v to just practice at your places for the checking of continuity. And also in the exercise of this chapter number 5, you can try out those numerical where you are given with the flow fields and you are asked to check the continuity of the flow field. Following flow fields are given to you. Three flow fields are given, A, B, and in part A, B, and C. So what is a flow field? It's actually the way to define a particular flow, to define the components of velocity, or to show that the velocity components are varying with this, how they are varying with respect to x and y. This is called as a flow field. So tell me the given flow field, whether they are two-dimensional or three-dimensional flow fields, and what's the reason? Any idea?
Two-dimensional, sir, because third component of velocity is given.
Yes. So all are the flow field given to you are two-dimensional because we are only given with the two dimensions of the directions of the velocity. So it means that we have to use two-dimensional continuity equation. And obviously, it is that's why it is important for us to know what type of flow field is given to us. Is it two-dimensional or three-dimensional? Okay, so let's further move. We have to use two-dimensional continuity equation, that is partial u or partial x plus partial v or partial y is equal to zero. And using this, we have to check whether the given flow fields are following continuity or not, whether they are continuous or not. Now, for this, first of all, let us take the first flow field, A, part A. U is given minus 2y and V is 3x. So we have to see the equation. We have to find partial U over partial x. And what is U? That is minus 2y. So partial of minus 2y over partial x is equal to 0. Is it a reason? Anybody can explain this? 0 come out here. Yes, partial of minus 2 over y over partial x is 0. And similarly, partial of 3x over partial y is equal to 0. Yes, any idea?
Sir, because minus 2y mein ek x ka component missing hai aur dusre case mein hamare paas y ka component missing hai jiske along wo partial ho raha hai.
Theek hai. To iska matlab hai ki jiske respect humne partial lena ho ya derivative lena ho, उस टर्म का उस कोई आंसर लेने के लिए उसमें होना ज़रूरी है. अगर नहीं होगी तो रिमेनिंग को हम कांस्टेंट ट्रीट करेंगे और डेरिवेटिव ऑफ कांस्टेंट जो है वो ज़ीरो होता है. ठीक है, तो ये जो माइनस टू वाई है इसको हम कांस्टेंट ले रहे हैं क्योंकि इसमें एक्स की कोई टर्म नहीं है, इसलिए ज़ीरो आएगा. इसी तरह थ्री एक्स को वाई के रिस्पेक्ट हम कांस्टेंट ले रहे हैं और इसलिए इसकी भी डेरिवेटिव ज़ीरो आएगा. सो एनी हाउ, सो ज़ीरो प्लस ज़ीरो, इफ़ यू पुट द वैल्यूज इन कॉन्टिन्यूटी इक्वेशन, सो ज़ीरो प्लस ज़ीरो ज़ीरो, इट मीन्स दैट the first flow field is following the continuity or it is a continuous flow field. On the same lines, we can do it for the part 3 and 2 and 3. In part 2, u is 0 and v is 3xy. So partial u over partial x. So partial of 0 over partial x is 0. And partial v over partial y. So partial of 3xy over partial y is 3x. This means you x, y ki term hai. So 3x by rajega, common rajega, constant hai. So 3x into partial y or partial y is 1. So it is 3x. So putting the values, partial u or partial x is 0 and partial v or partial y is 3x. So 0 plus 3x is obviously equal to 3x, which is not 0. It means that the second flow field is not following the continuity. Or it is not a continuous flow field. Our continuity is not satisfied. The third part is, you are given with u 2x.
B part mein, sir, B पार्ट में एक कंपोनेंट जीरो है तो ये वन डिमेंशनल फ्लो बन जाएगा.
जाहिर है इसमें एक कंपोनेंट जीरो आ गया ना, लेकिन वी जो है ना वो थ्री और एक्स और वाई दोनों पे वेरिएशन हो रही है. ठीक है, तो इस ये रहेगा टू डिमेंशनल ही क्योंकि वी जो है ना वो थ्री वो एक्स और वाई दोनों से डिपेंड कर रहा है. ठीक है,
ओके सर.
ओके जी, सो इसमें जो है तीसरा पार्ट जो है इसमें पार्शियल ऑफ 2x दैट इज़ u और पार्शियल x ये 2 आ जाएगा और पार्शियल ऑफ v दैट इज माइनस 2y और पार्शियल y माइनस 2 आ जाएगा. सो 2 माइनस 2 इज 0. इट मींस दैट द थर्ड फ्लो फील्ड इज आल्सो फॉलोइंग द कॉन्टीन्यूटी. तो जैसे मैंने बताया कि आप इसको डिफरेंट वैल्यूज ऑफ u एंड v पे खुद से भी कोई फ्लो फील्ड बना के ट्राई कर सकते हैं ताकि आप इसको ज़्यादा समझ सकें. और इसी तरह इस चैप्टर के एंड पे जैसे मैंने बताया कुछ नहीं हुए न्यूमेरिकल, वो भी आप कर सकते हैं जिसमें कॉन्टिन्यूटी वगैरह चेक करनी है. सो आई होप नाउ यू कैन डू दिस चेकिंग ऑफ कॉन्टिन्यूटी फॉर द फ्लो फील्ड. यू भी कर सकते हैं. एनी प्रॉब्लम एनी क्वेश्चन अप टिल नाउ? यस एवरीथिंग इज क्लियर about continuity derivation. I will advise you to do this derivation by yourself with your hands so that exam mein wagera mein aati hai aur वैसे भी इसको equation ko yaad rakhne ke liye behtar hai ki aap derivation ka aapko aani chahiye. Is tarah ye jo numericals hain aur different data ke sath bhi aap koshish kare isko karne ki. Simple one hai, to itni mushkil nahi hai ye. Okay ji, so let's continue and move forward and discuss rotational and irrotational flow. Now in these slides we'll define mathematically what is, first of all we'll define theoretically and then based on the derivation equation we'll define what is a rotational flow and what is an irrotational flow. So by definition, irrotational flow is the one in which each element of the fluid suffers no net rotation from one instant to the next instant. And with respect to given frame of reference, the classical example of the flow is Ferris wheel. Ferris wheel जो झूला बोलते हैं, जो रोटेट करता है, उसमें मुख्तलिफ चेयर्स लगी होती हैं मुख्तलिफ जगहों पर और वो चेयर्स टू एंड फ्रो मूव करती हैं, लेकिन परमानेंट रोटेशन उनमें नहीं होती, दोबारा अपनी जगह पर आ जाती हैं. सो यू कैन ऑल्सो सी इस पिक्चर एग्जाम्पल फ्रॉम इंटरनेट. फेरिस व्हील इज अ टिपिकल एग्जाम्पल, बेस्ट एग्जाम्पल ऑफ द इरोटेशनल फ्लो. सो सेम थिंग हैपन्स in irrotational flow, that when the fluid moves along a certain direction of flow, now within the fluid elements, if they are moving along a circular path, for example, or they are rotating by themselves, so if their rotation is such that their net rotation is zero, if they are moving in such a way that are rotating in such a way that their net rotation is zero, so it is called as irrotational flow. यानी कि पहले वो क्लॉक वाइज मूव कर रहे हैं, फिर काउंटर क्लॉक वाइज मूव कर रहे हैं, तो इस तरह टू एंड फ्रो या आगे पीछे मूव करके दोबारा अपनी असली हालत में आ जाते हैं, तो उसको हम बोलेंगे इरोटेशनल फ्लो. इन इरोटेशनल फ्लो द फ्लूड एलिमेंट मे डिफॉर्म, मीन शेप कैन चेंज, इंटरनल एंगल्स कैन चेंज, वे द एक्सिस ऑफ एलिमेंट मूव इक्वली टूवर्ड आर अवे फ्रॉम ईच अदर. सो इन इरोटेशनल फ्लो एक्सिस ऑफ द एलिमेंट ऑफ द फ्लूड दे मूव आइदर टूवर्ड ईच अदर are away from each other, but their movement is equal. Now the main thing in this is that as long as the algebraic average rotation is zero, the motion is irrotational. So jab tak jo algebraic average hai rotation ki, clockwise counter clockwise ka agar hum algebraic average le le, to agar wo dono same hain to motion jo hai wo irrotational hogi. On the other hand, in rotational flow there is net rotation of the element, but the deformation of the fluid element may be less as compared to irrotational flow. So in case of irrotational flow, momentarily deformation may be more, but overall net rotation is zero. But in case of rotational flow, the element will move you can say permanently, or its movement or rotation will be such that its net rotation is not zero from one time instant to next time instant. So same thing explained in the diagram. If you see this diagram, the first part, which is for the irrotational flow, you see there is one element of the fluid at any time t. It is in upright position, you can say. Its axes are perpendicular to each other. Now, for the next time interval after time delta t, this element has been rotated while moving along the direction of flow. So you can see the axes have been moved towards each other with equal you can say amount, that alpha and beta are same. Similar thing can happen that these axes can move away with equal amount, alpha and beta will again remain the same anyhow. But for the next time interval or after the next time interval, maybe this element will be again to its this position, or with respect to the given frame of reference it will be same. This is called as irrotational flow. On the other hand, if you see rotational flow, while moving while the elements moving along the flow, they are also rotating, and the rotational motion is such that the elements have been rotated and their axes have been now changed from this upright position to this direction, and this movement or this rotation is permanent, or this element will not come to its this original position. So this is called as the rotational flow. So this is about the irrotational and rotational flow, in which net algebraic sum, algebraic rotation of the element is zero in irrotational flow, and it is not zero in rotational flow. Now coming to the derivation or the mathematical expression to define rotation and rotational flow. So let us consider a small two-dimensional fluid element A, B, C, D at any time t, and during a short time interval delta t, it moves from one position to another position, and in the process it deforms as indicated in figure 5.3a. So if you see figure 5.3a, two positions of the elements have been shown, one at time t, element is A, B, C, D. So at any time t, this is the element which is given to us, and at any time t plus delta t, or after the time interval delta t, the element has been rotated, you can say counterclockwise, and now the face AB now becomes the face A dash B dash, and the angle between face AB and face A dash B dash is delta alpha. Similarly, face CD now has become C dash D dash, and the angle between face CD and C dash D dash is delta beta. So now in this diagram, the part B of the figure, we have considered or superimposed the two positions of the element, one at time t and one at time t plus delta t. So dono ko agar hum ikattha karke bana le aur isko thoda is tarah ek x aur y axis ke along kar le, to dusra jo hai automatically wo ek angle pe aa jayega. So these are the two positions of the same element which are superimposed at time t and time t plus delta t. So this is the element A, B, C, D, and this is the element A dash, B dash, C dash, D dash after rotation. Now the angle between AB and A dash B dash is delta alpha. It means that this element has moved along y-axis from point B to B dash. And how much movement has taken place from B to B dash? The velocity along y-axis is v. So partial v over partial x into delta x is the velocity at this point, or with which the movement has taken place from B to B dash. This partial V or partial X into delta X indicates the variation of velocity from this point to this point. So this is the distance covered from B to B dash, that is velocity into the time. You know that velocity is distance over time, and distance is velocity into time. This is the velocity with which the movement has taken place along Y axis, positive Y axis, partial V or partial X into delta X into delta T. So this is the distance covered by the element from B to B dash along y-axis, positive y-axis. Similarly, along negative x-axis, the movement has taken place from D to D dash, and this is with the velocity u along y-axis, x-axis velocity is u. So partial u or partial y, again showing the variation of velocity with respect to distance y into delta y. So this is the velocity with which the element has moved from point B, D to D dash, into delta t, the time interval over which this movement has taken place. Delta alpha is angle between A and B and A dash B dash, and delta beta is angle between C D and C this between this A dash D and A D and A dash D dash. Now further same thing is made over here. Considering figure 5.3b, which is in which positions of the fluid element two positions of the element are shown at any time t and t plus delta d, which are superimposed. Let delta x is and delta y are the dimensions of the element in x and y direction respectively. So now further we can write delta alpha, which is the angle between A dash B dash and AB, you can see in the diagram. So this angle is vertical over horizontal. This angle is vertical over horizontal. What is vertical distance? That is partial V or partial X into delta X into delta D, and horizontal distance is delta X. So what is delta alpha? That is partial V or partial X delta X into delta V, vertical, divided by delta X horizontal. So delta x will be cancelled. So it will be partial v or partial x into delta t. This is question number one, which is delta alpha. Rotation of phase AB with respect to A dash B dash with respect to AB. Then delta beta, which is the angle between A dash D dash and AD, which is the rotation of the phase AD with respect to A dash, phase AD, A dash D dash with respect to AD. So delta beta is again negative sign, showing that it is this rotation, this movement is on the negative x axis. So minus partial u or partial x into delta y into delta t, this is the distance, vertical distance, over delta y, it is the horizontal distance for this angle. So delta y will cancel, so minus partial u over partial y into delta t is the delta beta. Now rate of rotation, that is the rate of change of the angle per unit time. So delta alpha over delta t, which is omega alpha. So rate of rotation of phase AB of the element is delta alpha over delta t, and putting the value of delta alpha, which is partial v or partial x into delta t divided by delta t. So delta t will be cancelled in equation number 3. So we'll have the rate of rotation of phase AB as partial v over partial x. Similarly, rate of rotation of phase AD, which is omega beta, which is partial u minus partial u over partial y. Now equation 3 and 4, they are giving you the rotation of the faces of the element. Now the rotation of the element, overall element about z axis is out of plane axis. Agar aap figure dekhen to ye rotation ho rahi hai, ye about z axis ho rahi hai, x hai ye y hai. So out of plane jo axis hai wo z axis hai. So ye element jo hai z axis ke about rotate kar raha hai. तो हमने पहले इसके फेसिस की रोटेशन निकाली है, अब इसकी ओवरऑल जो रोटेशन है, तो रोटेशन ऑफ द एलिमेंट अबाउट जेड एक्सिस, नेट रोटेशन अबाउट जेड एक्सिस विल बी ओमेगा अल्फा प्लस ओमेगा बीटा डिवाइड बाय 2, दैट इज एवरेज ऑफ द रोटेशन ऑफ द टू फेसिस. सो दिस इज पुटिंग द वैल्यूज, विल हैव द पार्शियल वी ओवर पार्शियल एक्स माइनस पार्शियल यू ओवर पार्शियल वाई डिवाइड बाय 2. Now, for irrotational flow, remember this net rate of rotation of the element is 0. So, ye net rate of rotation hai, omega alpha plus omega beta divided by 2, ye 0 ho jayegi, jabke flow irrotational hoga. So, for irrotational flow, by definition, the net rate of rotation of the element is 0. So, putting the 0 over here, so we'll have 2, idhar chalke 0 ho jayega, constant hai. So, for irrotational flow, remember this is the condition that partial v over partial x minus partial u over partial y must be 0. This is the condition for the irrotational flow. Now for the rotational flow, partial v over partial x minus partial u over partial y is not 0. So jab ye net rotation 0 aayegi to irrotational flow hai, jab 0 nahi aayegi to ye rotational flow. So this is how mathematically we have defined rotational and irrotational flow. Yes, up till now, if anybody having any question, I hope you are clear now that what is the rotational flow and what is the irrotational flow. Yes, any comment, any idea on this? Any question you want to ask? Yes.
Sir, please explain that partial u or partial x into delta t, that term.
That is actually the distance covered from B to B dash. अब ये डिस्टेंस क्या होता है, दैट इज वेलोसिटी इनटू टाइम. ये क्लियर है?
यस सर.
ठीक है, तो ये टाइम तो डेल्टा टी आ गया, जिस टाइम में ये मूवमेंट हुई है. अब किस वेलोसिटी से मूवमेंट हुई है, वो वेलोसिटी अगर आप अलोंग डेल्टा एक्स मूव करें तो डिफरेंट पॉइंट्स पे जो वेलोसिटी है वो डिफरेंट होगी. ठीक है, वो डिपेंड कर रही है इस डिस्टेंस पे एंड विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द ओवरऑल डिस्टेंस. तो जब ये टर्म हम लिखते हैं partial v over partial x into delta x, या partial of anything over partial x into delta x, तो ये शो कर रहा होता है कि जो at the end of that distance है, जो overall change है वो क्या है, या overall वो component क्या है. ठीक है, तो ये जो velocity है इस point पे वो ये है जिससे ये b से b dash movement हुई है. ठीक है, clear है?
Okay sir, thank you.
Okay जी, now moving further, let us use these equations to check the rotational or irrotational flows. कि जो हमें जो फ्लो फील्ड दिए गए हैं, क्या वो रोटेशनल है, वेदर दे आर रोटेशनल आर इज रोटेशनल, दैट वी हैव टू चेक ओवर हियर. सो अगेन द सेम फ्लो फील्ड वी कैन कंसीडर in the first example. So we can use the equation of irrotational flow or rotational flow, and we can accordingly put the values and check it. So we know that partial v over partial x minus partial u over partial y is equal to 0 is the condition for irrotational flow. So putting the values, we know partial, we know v is 3x. So partial of 3x over partial x is 3, and we know u is minus 2y in the first part. So partial of minus 2y over partial y is minus 2. I hope you can do this derivative, it's clear, a simple one. Now putting the values, partial v over partial x is 3, and partial u over partial y is minus 2. So 3 minus minus 2, it is 5. So obviously 5 is not 0, so it means that this flow field is a rotational flow field. Similarly, we can check it for part B. U is 0, v is 3xy. So putting v 3xy, so partial of 3xy or partial x is 3y, and partial of u or partial u is 0, partial of u 0 or partial y is 0. So ye values hum put kar de, partial v over partial x jo hai wo 3y hai, minus partial u or partial y, partial v or partial x is 3y, and partial u or partial y is 0. So 3y minus 0 is not 0, obviously. So again, the second flow field is also rotational. For third flow field, u is 2x, v is minus 2y. So putting the values, partial v over partial x. So v jo hai minus 2y hai. So partial of minus 2y over partial x, ye 0 aa jayega. Again, wahi reason hai ki isme x ki term nahi hai. Aur partial u over partial y. So u 2x is partial of 2x over partial y, 0 aa jayega again. So isme bhi chuki y ki term nahi hai. 0 minus 0 is 0. So flow is irrotational in the third flow field. So this is how we can check the continuity and irrotationality of the flow field or rotationality of the flow field. Now, in the next problem, you are asked to check the continuity and irrotationality of the following flow field. Dono cheeze check karni hai humne ki flow continuous hai ya nahi hai, ya dusra hai ki wo irrotational hai ya rotational hai. You are given the flow field u is 2 and v is 8x. So first of all, you can check the continuity. Again, it is a two-dimensional flow field. So we know that two-dimensional continuity equation is partial u over partial x plus partial v over partial y is equal to 0. So iska partial u over partial x pehle find kar le, u 2 hai, so partial of 2 over partial x 0 aa jayega, aur v 8x hai, so partial of 8x over partial y bhi 0 aa jayega. So 0 plus 0 is 0. It means that the given flow field is a continuous flow field. ये continuous flow field है. इसी तरह इसकी rotationality वगैरह भी check कर सकते हैं हम. इसमें question जो है irrotational flow की वो है partial v over partial x minus partial u over partial y is equal to 0. तो अगर ये satisfy होती है तो ये irrotational flow होगा, नहीं होती तो rotational flow होगा. If you put the values, v जो है 8x है और u 2 है. So partial of 8x over partial x is 8 and partial of u, which is 2, over partial y is 0. So 8 minus 0, answer क्या आएगा? 8, which is not equal to 0. It means that it is a rotational flow field. So this is how we can check the rotational or irrotational flow field using the mathematical expression for these flows. Now at the end of this lecture, let us discuss circulation and vorticity. So let us let the streamlines shown in figure 5.4 represent a two-dimensional flow field, while L represent any closed path in this field. So if you see the diagram, the arrow lines, they are the flow lines, are the stream lines, which are showing the average direction of flow of the fluid. So ye bata rahi hai ki is direction mein fluid ka flow ho raha hai, aur isi flow ke duran jo fluid ke kuch elements hain ya ek element of fluid jo hai, which is differential element of the fluid dl, it is following a circular path, it is moving in circulation, and the length of this closed path is l. So these are the streamlines showing the average direction of flow of the fluid, and within this flow, the fluid elements, a differential element of the fluid, is moving in a closed path, and the length of the closed path is L. Now, what is circulation? By definition, circulation, which is represented by gamma letter, is defined mathematically as the line integral of the velocity about a closed path. So, line integral of velocity about the closed path. So this show the line integral, integration sign with a circle at the center in L, line integral along the line integral is. So, if you add the velocities along the circular closed path, so that is with respect to the length, that is the circulation. So, line integral into V, velocity vector into dl, and actually the velocity having component along the circular path is V cos beta. So, if you put the value this, it will be line integral of V cos beta into dl. V is the velocity in the flow field at the element dl of the path, which is actually tangent to the flow line. What is V? It is tangent to the flow line at the point of element. And beta is the angle between the velocity and the tangent to the path at the point in positive direction along path. What is the, this is the differential element of the fluid. So at this differential element, if you draw a tangent to the flow path, a streamline, it is velocity vector. And the angle between this velocity vector and the tangent to the closed path at that point with the direction along the positive direction, positive flow direction. Flow direction is taraf hai, so angle bhi clockwise hoga is saaf se. So angle beta is the clockwise angle between the tangent to the circular, the closed path and tangent to the streamline, that is the velocity vector, is the beta angle. Similarly, when this element moves over here at this point, if you draw the tangent to the streamline, it is V, and if you draw a tangent to the closed path, so the angle between the tangent and this V is beta along the positive flow direction, clockwise over here in this case. Similarly, if the element comes to this point, so if you draw tangent to the flow line, this is V, and if you draw tangent to the closed path, and the angle between this closed path and the velocity along the positive flow direction is again beta. So this is how the beta angle is defined. So circulation is the line integral of the velocity along a closed path, that is known as the circulation. And mathematically, it is written like this. Now, since the element is of differential size, the resulting circulation is also differential. So for the differential element of fluid, the circulation will also be differential. So d gamma, differential circulation, is given by this expression. So you have to keep in mind this expression. Its derivation is not part of the course. It will not be considered covered. So you just keep this thing in mind that this differential circulation is partial V over partial X minus partial U over partial Y into dx into dy. dx into dy is the area enclosed for the given two-dimensional plane. Area enclosed is dx into dy. Now next term is the vorticity. Vorticity, which is indicated by the letter xi, as you can see, is defined as a circulation per unit enclosed area. So circulation per unit enclosed area is known as xi or vorticity, and by mathematically it is d gamma, differential circulation, divided by dx over dy. So d gamma is, you know, this partial v over partial x minus partial u over partial y into dx into dy divided by dx into dy, area enclosed. So finally the vorticity is partial x over partial y minus partial u or partial y. So what is this? This is same equation as we have derived for rotational and irrotational flow. It means that if this partial v or partial x minus partial u or partial y is zero, it means it is irrotational flow. So vorticity will be zero. So it means that for irrotational flow, vorticity is zero and it has certain value for the rotational flow. We have is my final conclusion. At the end, another numerical you can do, check the irrotationality of the following flow field and calculate the vorticity as well. So, aapko ek flow field diya gaya hai, usne kaha hai ki irrotationality bhi check kare aur vorticity ki value bhi find kare. So, we know that in two-dimensional form, partial v or partial x minus partial u or partial y is equal to zero. This is the condition for irrotational flow. Now finding the values partial v or partial x. V is 0. Partial of 0 or partial x is 0. U is 25y. So partial of 25y over partial y is 25. Putting the values. So 0 minus 25 is minus 25, which is obviously not 0. So it means that this flow field is not rotational. It is not irrotational. It is a rotational flow field. So flow is rotational and vorticity is minus 25. क्योंकि अगर इसका कोई आंसर आएगा तो आंसर वोर्टिसिटी के बराबर होगा. अगर नहीं आएगा जीरो होगा तो वोर्टिसिटी का मतलब जीरो है, जो कि एयर रोटेशनल फ्लो के लिए. सो दिस इज अबाउट टुडेज लेक्चर. सो विल कंटिन्यू फ्रॉम दिस पॉइंट नेक्स्ट टाइम. आई होप इट इज सफिशिएंट फॉर यू फॉर दिस लेक्चर. क्योंकि काफ़ी है कि और पढ़ लें?
काफ़ी है सर.
सो नाउ आई विल मूव टू द क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन. इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन प्लीज आस्क नाउ. Before I wind up this and take your tender. ये किसी का question है पूछने इस अच्छे से?
Yes sir, vorticity का physical meaning बता दें.
Physical meaning vorticity या vortex flow से ही है ना. जब कोई element of fluid जो है circular path में move कर रहा है तो अब सर्कुलेशन किससे रिलेटेड है? मैथमेटिकली आपको बता दिया और सर्कुलेशन पर यूनिट इंक्लोज्ड एरिया. ठीक है, तो फिजिकली यही है कि कोई चीज़ सर्कुलर मोशन में है या सर्कुलरली मूव कर रही है या वॉर्टेक्स फ्लो में है. ठीक है,
ओके सर, थैंक यू.
यस, एनी अदर क्वेश्चन
सर?
जी,
और ये डेल्टा बीटा की इक्वेशन में माइनस के बारे में,
एक मिनट, डेल्टा बीटा की इक्वेशन में माइनस नहीं आया है कि जो मूवमेंट हुई है एलिमेंट की डी से डी डैश वो नेगेटिव एक्स एक्सिस की तरफ हुई है, इसलिए नेगेटिव साइन के साथ ये डिस्टेंस आएगा. ठीक है, क्यों भी क्लियर है?
वोर्टिसिटी का एप्लीकेशन वगैरह बता दो.
जाहिर है वोर्टेक्स फ्लो में ही है. अब इसकी यहाँ पे तो हम मैथमेटिकली उसको डिफाइन कर रहे हैं. अब इसका आगे फर्दर किस तरह का यूज़ है इस इक्वेशन का, वो जाहिर है यहाँ पे इस स्कोप में नहीं है. आप बस यही जहन में रखेंगे इसकी डेफिनेशन मैथमेटिकली किस तरह इसको डिफाइन किया जा सकता है. वैसे ज़ाहिर वोर्टेक्स फ्लो की ही समझ आती है कि जिसमें इसको अप्लाई किया जा सकता है, और वोर्टेक्स फ्लो की जाहिर है काफ़ी प्रैक्टिकल एप्लीकेशन भी हैं. कई जगहों पे बात करते वोर्टेक्स फ्लो होता है जिसको हमें कैलकुलेट या उसको देखना होता है. यस, एनी अदर क्वेश्चन
सर? आइडेंटिकल इन पैरेलल प्लेन्स का क्या मतलब है?
आइडेंटिकल मीन सेम. पैरेलल प्लेन यानी कि एक्स वाई प्लेन को अगर हम चार हमारे पास स्ट्रीम लाइन्स हैं जाहिर है एक ही प्लेन में एक्स वाई प्लेन में, तो अगर हम उनको अलहदा कर लें और उनके प्लेन्स को भी पैरेलल कर लें, अलहदा कर लें, तो ये उसका मतलब है कि जब हर स्ट्रीम लाइन को हम उसके प्लेन में शो करेंगे अलहदा से तो वो एक जैसी लगेंगी. ठीक है,
ओके सर.
यस, एनी अदर क्वेश्चन? यस, so you should go through these slides jo maine pehle bataya ki I have provided the link for that and also the slide for the next lecture you should go through before the next lecture. So I will also make sure that this recording is available to you in this week, at the end of this week, so that you can also go through it later. So before I take your attendance again, I will ask any question if you have from this today's discussion, introduction and the topic that we have started. So you are welcome to ask.
सर हम कह सकते हैं कि सर्कुलेशन जो है वो रोटेशन बताती है एक प्रॉपर एनक्लोज्ड एरिया की, और जो वोर्टिसिटी है वो रोटेशन बताती है एक एनी पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट की.
वोर्टिसिटी जो है सर्कुलेशन पर यूनिट एनक्लोज्ड एरिया. ठीक है, तो सर्कुलेशन इटसेल्फ जो है वो बेसिकली जब एक एलिमेंट ऑफ द फ्लूइड जो है वो सर्कुलर पाथ में मूव करेगा तो उसकी जो वेलोसिटी का लाइन इंटीग्रल है वो सर्कुलेशन है. ठीक है, तो उसको जब हम इंक्लोज्ड एरिया पे डिवाइड कर देंगे या सर्कुलेशन पर यूनिट एरिया आप कह लें, दैट इज वोर्टिसिटी. ठीक है,
ओके सर.
सर्कुलेशन तो इटसेल्फ एक फिनोमिना है ना, कि मूवमेंट है उसकी एलिमेंट की और एक सर्टन वेलोसिटी के साथ क्लोज पाथ में मूव कर रहा है, तो उस क्लोज पाथ की जो वेलोसिटी का लाइन इंटीग्रल है वो सर्कुलेशन है. अब उसको अगर पर यूनिट एरिया पे लेंगे तो वो वोर्टिसिटी आएगी.
सर्कुलेशन लेकिन बता तो हमें रोटेशन ही रहा है ना.
जी जी रोटेशन ऑफ द एलिमेंट ऑफ द फ्लूइड है. ठीक है.
यस सर.
इसमें जरूरी नहीं कि पूरे का पूरा फ्लूइड ही सर्कुलर मोशन में हो, जैसे हमने स्पीकर में बताया भी है मैंने कि एक्चुअली जो एवरेज जो फ्लो डायरेक्शन है वो उस तरह से सर्कुलर पाथ में नहीं है, ये एवरेज फ्लो डायरेक्शन है. लेकिन उस फ्लो के अंदर जो एलिमेंट्स हैं वो कुछ जो है इस तरह मूव कर रहे हैं, पूरा फ्लूइड इस तरह मूव नहीं कर रहा. ठीक है. तो ये एलिमेंट्स से रिलेटेड एक डेफिनेशन है. वोर्टेक्स फ्लो में तो आप कह सकते हैं कि पूरे का पूरा शायद वो मोशन ही वोर्टेक्स में हो रही होती है, यहाँ एलिमेंट्स की मोशन ली जा रही है. ठीक है. फ्लूइड की, पूरे फ्लूइड की नहीं ली जा रही.
ओके सर, थैंक यू
जी. एनी अदर क्वेश्चन? ओके जी. सो आई विल एंड द रिकॉर्डिंग ओवर हियर एंड आई विल टेक योर अटेंडेंस नाउ. अभी चूंकि बहुत काफ़ी लोगों ने शायद LMS की उस तरह से रजिस्टर नहीं किया हुआ, तो इसको भी काइंडली आप रजिस्ट्रेशन को भी पूरा करें. नेक्स्ट टाइम तक कोशिश करें कि तमाम जो है जिन्होंने सब्जेक्ट लेना है वो रजिस्टर हो जाएं, ताकि मैं डायरेक्टली उसी पे अटेंडेंस लगा सकूं. वो मेरे लिए ज़्यादा कन्वीनियंट होगा कि उसका रिकॉर्ड साथ साथ रखा जा सके. सो आज तो मैं वैसे ही अटेंडेंस की लूँगा आपकी.